Welcome to The Inquiry with me, Tanya Beckett. One question, four expert witnesses, and an answer. It was, in some ways, a rather strange and rambling piece of writing that appeared last year on the Russian government's website. In some 6,000 words, it gave what, in some places, was a very detailed account of many centuries of the joint history of Russia and Ukraine. A central claim was that the countries of Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus belonged together as a single ancient Slavic state, and that at the start of last century, Ukraine had invented itself as a fictitious country. The essay would probably have attracted little attention if it wasn't for its author, Russia's President Vladimir Putin. So this week on The Inquiry, we're asking, does Putin's view of history explain why he invaded Ukraine?
Part 1. The State of Rus.
Both Russia and Ukraine trace their origins to an ancient state called Kievan Rus that emerged in the 9th century. Interestingly, it was actually founded by Vikings.
Over 1,000 years ago, tribes living in the lands between the Baltic and Black Seas joined to live under the leadership of traders that had come from Scandinavia. Our first expert witness is Faith Hillis, professor of Russian history at the University of Chicago.
Prior to that moment, the Slavs were living in loose tribal confederations. They'd not had an organized state. But according to legends, these warring tribes invited these Scandinavian traders who were bringing furs up and down the Dnipro River from Scandinavia to Byzantium, and they invited them to form their first state. So the state emerges, and it is called Rus.
So just to be clear, at that point, the Slavs are Ukrainians and Russians are one and the same thing or not?
Well, I would say they're neither Ukrainians nor Russians. The Rus state also brings in non-Slavic peoples as well. So there are animists, there are Muslims, there are Jews who live on the steppe. Some live as hunters and gatherers. People are sort of moving around across borders. And the amazing thing about Rus is it's able to pull all of these people together.
The capital of Rus was Kiev. And part of what came to bind its people was the Orthodox faith, a strand of Christianity which had originated from the Eastern Roman Empire.
Many of them end up converting to Orthodoxy, not all of them. Rus remains a multi-ethnic state, but Orthodoxy does become the glue that holds this complex polity together.
Then, in the 13th century, came the invasion of the Mongols to the lands of Rus, dividing its Slavic people into three distinctive modern-day nations, Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus. The Mongol Empire went into decline in the 14th century, but for the people in the lands near Kiev, a new threat emerged. The expansion of Poland brought with it a ruling class who were not Orthodox Christians, but Roman Catholics.
In the 16th century, you begin to get, as the Polish rule expands in the south, you begin to get a dissident group of Orthodox believers who don't like the way that this Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth is operating. And they are called the Cossacks. And they eventually come to see themselves as the muscle of the Orthodox people who they see as oppressed by Poles and by Catholicism.
In the mid-17th century, we reach an important moment for Russian-Ukrainian history. Slavs in Kiev, who were under the rule of the Poles, and those in Moscow, who were part of the Tsardom of Russia, form an Orthodox Christian alliance.
Here is where we get into contemporary debates about nationality.
Was the word Ukraine used at that time?
Yes, the Cossacks did use the word Ukraine, and the Cossacks also often hearkened back to Rus and used the word Rus to argue that this was the legacy of Orthodoxy that they were defending. The Cossacks do not, however, talk about themselves as Russian or the area as Russia. They understand the area that they are defending as Ukraine.
We're now moving into the 1700s, And as the Tsardom of Russia becomes the Russian Empire, the eastern part of Ukraine becomes part of that empire. At first, some independence for Ukraine was tolerated. That is, until the end of the century and the reign of Catherine the Great.
The survival of this area that has its own unique culture, its own unique governance institutions, its own unique leaders, she sees this as impossible to reconcile with the autocracy that she wants to build.
Right, so she crushes it.
She crushes it. And it had, you know, still a formal territory, and Catherine abolishes this territory and abolishes the institutions that the Cossacks had used to rule themselves. So she integrates the Cossack elite into the all-imperial nobility, thereby depriving them of this freedom that they had enjoyed.
So what's happened to the Ukrainians in the east is that their land is now referred to as Little Russia. Meanwhile, those in the west have now become part of the Austrian, later the Austro-Hungarian Empire, run by a dynasty called the Habsburgs. And the two empires are in competition.
By the late 19th century, the Habsburg government also realizes that Ukrainian nationalism may be an Achilles heel for the Russian Empire. And they begin promoting Ukrainian nationalism, funding Ukrainian publications, encouraging Ukrainian activists to reach out to their brethren in the Russian Empire, precisely because they believe that it will undermine the Russian state.
It was, of course, this sort of antagonism that underpinned the eruption of global conflict in 1914. 4 years later, when the First World War ended, both the Austro-Hungarian and Russian empires were finished. One was broken up in defeat, and the other overthrown by revolution. But the years that followed were to bring the birth of another great power, the USSR.
Part 2. The Soviet Union.
In the turmoil that followed the end of the First World War and the Russian Revolution, the map of Europe was redrawn. Ukrainians tried to create their own independent state. But this was not to last, according to our second expert witness. Serhii Plokhy is professor of history and director of the Ukrainian Research Institute at Harvard University.
Ukrainians emerged after the end of World War I as the largest ethnic and national group in Europe, with so-called unresolved national or nationality question, in the sense that they were there, they were mobilized, but they failed to achieve their own statehood and were divided as a result.
Ukraine was divided between Poland, Czechoslovakia, Romania, and most importantly, absorbed into the Soviet Union as a Soviet Socialist Republic, under the leadership of Vladimir Lenin and the Bolshevik Party. It was a moment in history that Russia's current president, Vladimir Putin, sees as a terrible mistake, because the Soviet Republic included lands he considers as rightfully Russian: eastern Ukraine and, most significantly, the area around Luhansk and Donetsk. In the chaos of these early post-war years, Ukrainians found a degree of freedom for cultural expression.
The Bolshevik power is quite weak originally, and they have to accommodate different national movements that were taking place and were there on the territory of the former Russian Empire. So to keep in control, they made a number of cultural concessions in terms of language, in terms of recognition of Ukrainians to be a separate nation, having a separate republic. So the Bolsheviks had to accept the reality on the ground.
But as the years rolled by, the grip of the Soviets tightened. In the early 1930s, policies aimed at industrializing the economy targeted farmers on fertile Ukrainian land, leaving them without food. The result was widespread famine.
It happens in 1932, 1933. where up to 4 million of Ukrainians die, mostly peasants. And again, they were not only ethnic Ukrainians, there were others as well, but the ethnic Ukrainians constituted the majority, as they constituted the majority of the population living in the villages in the countryside.
Nearly 4 million people died, over a tenth of Ukraine's population. But before the Soviet Union finally reached its demise over half a century later, there was a second global conflict and another part of Ukraine's history to which Vladimir Putin often refers, collaboration with Nazi Germany in World War II.
1939, Hitler attacks Poland. Again, Ukrainians are the largest ethnic minority in Poland at that time. The Ukrainian nationalists support the German military intelligence in particular. So they look at the Germans as their allies against the Poles, whom they consider to be the oppressors. So the Ukrainian nationalist movement makes this alliance with Nazi Germany.
But as the reality of this alliance with the Nazis became clear, it swiftly came to an end.
Once the Germans move into Ukraine, those the same nationalists declare the independence of Ukraine and almost immediately being arrested by the Germans. So by the end of 1941, all factions of Ukrainian nationalists are in war with Nazi Germany. Hitler takes over the rest of Ukraine by 1941, 1942. The majority of Ukrainians who fight in that war, millions and millions, fight the war in the ranks of the Red Army.
At the end of the Second World War, the map of Europe is again redrawn, and Ukraine expands with the addition mainly of former Polish lands. Ukrainians were once again united as one state, but not as an independent nation. They were part of the Soviet Union.
What you see is that Stalin takes over the entire territory of Ukraine, not only eastern and central that was held by the Soviet Union before the war, but also all these parts that were under the jurisdiction of Poland, of Czechoslovakia and then Hungary, and of Romania as well. So creating very much today's map of Ukraine, but keeping it under the full control.
Ukrainians consistently pushed back against Moscow, with high numbers being sent to prison camps. But in 1989, after nearly seven decades of Soviet control, came the collapse of the Berlin Wall and the subsequent unravelling of the USSR.
Part 3, Ukraine's independence.
In December 1991, the leaders of Russia, Belarus and Ukraine gathered for a hastily arranged meeting in Belarus. By the time the talks were finished, all three countries had agreed to leave the USSR. The Soviet era was over. We're now at the start of the 1990s, and Ukraine became a sovereign nation for the first time in over 70 years. Our third expert witness is Margarita Balmaceda, professor at Seton Hall University in America.
It's independent, but those first years were very, very, very rough for Ukraine.
For ordinary Ukrainian families, life was extremely hard.
What you see in that period is a situation where the mines cannot pay their workers, the mines cannot pay their suppliers. Whatever company needs to buy that coal, perhaps for the production of steel, cannot pay for it. So there is a crisis of access to currency, there is a crisis of how to connect different parts of the system, and this is going to have all kinds of effects, both in terms of political relations within Ukraine and also in terms of relations with Russia.
One thing Ukrainian households could depend upon was cheap fuel. 80% of Russian natural gas exports to Western Europe traveled through Ukraine. And in exchange for operating the pipeline, Ukrainians were able to buy it at low prices. The arrangement offered some degree of support to ordinary Ukrainians. But it also left the door open to some shadowy dealings. Corruption wasn't the only problem. Russia's power to turn off the gas taps gave it enormous sway in Ukraine's security and politics. And there was another channel through which Moscow could exert influence. Much of Ukraine's industrial wealth, including the big commercial city called Donetsk, lay in the east. This was also home to a large population of Russian speakers, many of whom had moved there during the days of the Soviet Union.
There is a wonderful slogan that perhaps explains how politics worked in that period, and that is, politics is made in Kyiv, money is made in Donetsk. And the basic idea here is that Donetsk economic actors or oligarchs, if you wish, would have a level of autonomy to do whatever they wanted, including corrupt deals, while formally leaving the governing or the political side to Kyiv.
But 2004 brought important change to Kyiv's politics. In the presidential elections, there was a runoff between Russian-backed Prime Minister Viktor Yanukovych and his West-leaning opponent, Viktor Yushchenko. Yanukovych was declared winner, but there were widespread accusations of vote rigging, and protests erupted in the capital. The uprising was dubbed the Orange Revolution, orange being the campaign colour of the losing candidate, Yushchenko.
There is a call for new elections, and when those elections take place, those are indeed free and fair, and that's when Mr. Yushchenko becomes president in 2004. It was a huge political movement. It showed Ukrainians' desire for democracy, for real democracy as opposed to a party of power, Ukrainians' desire for less corruption.
It was a moment of great hope for the country. Inflation fell, the economy grew, and investment flooded in. The sense of a national identity flourished. But when the global financial crisis hit in 2008, this brief period of confidence evaporated.
The Orange Revolution was a tremendous watershed in Ukrainian politics, undoubtedly. I was there for part of the time. I lived every moment, even when I was not there, lived through it. But in reality, it did not lead to the real changes people expected. And that is perhaps the reason why Yanukovych was able to come back a few years later.
Viktor Yanukovych did indeed return as leader of Ukraine. He narrowly won elections in 2010, drawing heavily on support from Russian speakers in the east of the country. But his presidency was to spark another revolution, only this time with much more lasting consequences. Time for our fourth expert witness.
Part 4. Maidan.
Sergey Radchenko is visiting professor at Cardiff University in the UK.
The key thing to understand here about Ukraine is that it was effectively divided into generally Ukrainian-speaking western parts of Ukraine and the eastern parts of Ukraine that were, you know, populated by ethnic Russians. And so that just tended to play out in elections.
Just 6 years after the Orange Revolution, Viktor Yanukovych won the presidency in elections that this time were deemed to be free and fair. His support was underpinned by Russian speakers in the east of Ukraine, in the republics of Luhansk, Donetsk, and Crimea.
It's not all that remarkable that Yanukovych was able to roll back into office. In other words, you know, if, for example, under Yushchenko suddenly there was some sort of a dramatic economic takeoff and Ukraine prospered, etc., then maybe elections would turn out differently. But I think Yanukovych had genuine popularity in parts of the electorate, certainly from the eastern part of the country.
Is it possible to say that he was putting on the table a more Western-leaning policies and approach?
Yanukovych played both sides. Now, of course, he's seen as a Russian stooge. I don't know that he was seen as a Russian stooge back then. He was sort of playing to both sides, and he was, of course, interested in developing Ukraine's relationship with the European Union, but he was also not turning his back on Russia.
But in 2013, Viktor Yanukovych was forced to choose. On the eve of signing an association agreement with the European Union, he suddenly backed out because of pressure from Russia. Many Ukrainians in the west of the country felt their hopes for a better future had been dashed. Demonstrations erupted on Kiev's Maidan Square. They lasted for weeks and turned violent. Over 100 were killed. But in the end, the protesters prevailed, and President Yanukovych fled to Russia. The view from Moscow was that the Ukrainian government had been overthrown by Western powers. This, alongside the perception that the NATO military alliance was creeping towards Russian borders, led to action. Russian forces took effective control of Luhansk and Donetsk. Russia also declared the Black Sea Peninsula of Crimea as part of Russia, including the strategically important port of Sevastopol.
The Ukrainians were never quite able to forge a united kind of national identity that would work for both sides of the country. And as a result of the violence of 2014 and then the effective proclamation of the separatist entities in Donbass and Donetsk and Luhansk, what we had is a movement of people who were really pro-Russian, who really kind of believed in close association with Russia into those areas, but many others fled.
Fighting followed and peace deals were struck, but there were persistent disagreements over their interpretation. Then, in February 2022, after a prolonged build-up of forces on the Ukrainian border, Russia's army invaded Ukraine. So now we come back to our question. Does Putin's view of history explain why he invaded Ukraine? For Vladimir Putin, the intertwining of the history of Russia and Ukraine is not just a fact of the past. He wants to make it a reality for the future, which means denying the nationhood of a state which has been independent for the past 30 years. As our final witness, Sergey Radchenko, says about President Putin's most recent speech on Ukraine and Russia's history, Putin is not just looking to the past, he's trying to bring it back.
What does he want to do here? Is he trying to recreate some sort of Russian empire? If you read his speech, you would almost conclude that this is what he's trying to do. You know, it seems like he's living in the 19th century and he is dreaming of some sort of empires that simply don't exist anymore.
This inquiry was presented by me, Tanya Beckett, and produced by Sheila Cook. And the sound engineer is Graham Puddyfoot.